This is an unusual shop selling a wide range of goods, mostly quite cheap. So what's the attraction for customers?
Well, I think that you soms wel goedkoopjes kunt doen, maar het moet juist interesseren ook.
It's here that many of the goods seized from criminals are disposed of, a sale room and shop run by Belgium's finance ministry. You'd expect criminal assets to include top-end cars, but the range is wide.
Des voitures, pièces à conviction du greffe saisies. Ici, on a un moteur de Porsche, l'art africain, toute une série d'outillages qui est saisi auprès d'un entrepreneur non agréé.
Not everything in the Finn shop counts as criminal assets, like this marijuana growing kit, but it's where many end up. Police seize them and they're held pending a confiscation order from the courts.
When the magistrates give the possibility to sell that car, the Finn shop will sell the car. If there are, for example, diamonds or jewelry, gold, whatsoever, they will contact our office, and at that moment we will give the possibility to put this away in our safes as long as necessary.
Criminal assets have been described by the European Commission as the financial incentive driving crime. The EU would like to see some harmonisation of approach where cross-border criminality is involved, although justice remains the responsibility of individual member states.
If we don't go after the money across all borders, then we cannot fight effectively organized crime or terrorism. So this is the most important. It's more important than to put some people behind bars.
There's disagreement over the EU's legal role, which MEPs hope to settle at a meeting in Strasbourg next week. One issue concerns confiscation from third parties, people who've benefited from crime in which they played no part, but it's hard to prove.
Do you confiscate assets only if a third party knew that they were receiving assets, or if they should have known, or indeed you just confiscate those assets anyway?
The United Nations estimates that in 2009 the profits from crime reached $2.1 trillion, 3.6% of global output. Only a tiny fraction has ever been seized by the authorities.
Bienvenue à Capelle op den Bosch. Nous sommes à 35 km de Bruxelles, où vous trouvez les deux usines d'amiante ciment les plus importantes au monde.
Eric Jonker is guiding us through what for him is a forgotten war zone. Once his home village, it's where the production of vast quantities of asbestos, until its Europe-wide ban 10 years ago, is alleged to have caused, and to continue to cause, hundreds of deaths from lung cancer and another disease, mesothelioma.
Voilà, ça c'est l'amiante.
Vous voyez, on voit très bien les fibres. Et quand on pense que les cris les plus alarmistes disent que inhaler une fibre comme ça peut vous être fatal.
It's been a long fight, starting after his parents and two brothers died from asbestos-related disease.
Il faut que le pollueur devienne le payeur, puisqu'il est maintenant, les cours de justice ont prouvé qu'ils savaient et qu'ils n'ont pas pris les mesures.
Now, MEPs are pushing for more legislation, over and above the asbestos eradication steps taken in the last two decades. Next month, they will vote on measures to identify and clean asbestos hotspots, train workers in the remaining dangers, and address outstanding compensation issues.
Es gilt hier nicht Panik zu machen, die Leute nicht in Aufregung zu bringen, aber die Leute sollen wissen, in dieser Schule oder in diesem öffentlichen Gebäude oder in diesem Schwimmbad kann Asbest, ist Asbest, und wenn dann Arbeiten getätigt werden, dann muss die Versorgung dann stattfinden.
They also want to stop the export of the problem by European companies, which continue to manufacture asbestos-containing products abroad.
Das finde ich auch unmöglich, dass wir die Umweltlasten, die wir vielleicht in Deutschland oder in anderen europäischen Ländern vermeiden wollen mit der Produktion von Asbest, dass wir die in andere Länder verlagern, wo noch nicht mal die entsprechenden Schutzvorschriften für die Menschen, die damit arbeiten oder für den Abfall dann auch überhaupt vorhanden sind.
This is an initiative which MEPs hope will yield more action on asbestos. Eric Jonker is hoping it'll help increase awareness and ultimately strengthen his campaign.
Access to clean drinking water is a universal right, an absolute necessity, especially for the poorest and most disadvantaged segments of society. Here in the EU, a campaign is gaining momentum, the first of its kind to secure water rights for all. Under the very first European Citizens Initiative, the Commission is handing over the reins to the people to decide what should be protected by EU law. If you can get a million signatories to your petition in seven different countries, the Commission will then consider legislating on your proposal. The European Federation of Public Service Unions are petitioning for water and sanitation to be considered as a human right and not as a commodity that is sold for profit.
We wanted to open a debate about the management of our essential services, and we think that water is one of them. I mean, we shouldn't really go around trying to make cash out of something vital for the human development and also for the economy.
But there's a snag. MEPs in the Internal Market Committee are discussing the liberalisation of water services and have voted in favour of a new public procurement directive that would open up water services to a more transparent system of privatisation.
Very rarely the quality improves, and very often this leads to corruption and scandals and envelopes under the table.
But according to one MEP, everyone's got it wrong. There's no contradiction. The new law could put an end to differential pricing in member states such as Germany and the Netherlands.
Le vote en IMCO dans la commission du marché intérieur n'est pas un vote qui confisque l'eau. C'est au contraire un vote qui donne au pouvoir public la capacité de choisir le mode de gestion de l'eau.
So according to Mr. Juvin, the new legislation means greater transparency and competition, hence no fraud. Sounds lovely. But the new public procurement directive could be put forward at the next plenary. So what then becomes of the Citizens' Water Initiative? Will the Commission put public protection first?
And we also hope that politicians and the members of the European Parliament and the Commission and the Council will take this seriously, because it's the only mechanism they have to hear people.
Salut! Uniunea Europeană este unul dintre cei mai mari importatori de energie din lume, în special gaz și petrol. Acest lucru afectează serios economia. Până în 2020 va trebui să economisim energie. Pentru a realiza acest lucru, statele membre vor trebui să adopte noi reguli. Dacă Europa poate reduce consumul de energie cu 20%, se vor economisi 50 de miliarde de euro în fiecare an, iar atmosfera va fi mai puțin poluată. Dar nu vom îngheța de frig. Guvernele vor trebui să fie un exemplu în acest sens, nu cetățenii. Cum? Clădirile utilizate de guvern sau instituții de stat vor trebui să se îmbrace mai gros. Ministerele, băncile naționale, tribunalele, etc. De asemenea și instituțiile europene. O parte din clădirile publice vor trebui renovate sau prin implementarea de programe eficiente de economisire a energiei. Ideile nu lipsesc în acest domeniu. De exemplu, în Marea Britanie, o firmă din Manchester reciclează blugi vechi ca material de izolare a pereților. Așadar, nu metoda contează. Izolarea acoperișurilor, geamuri duble, surse de căldură alternative. Atâta timp cât statele găsesc o metodă de a reduce consumul de energie, este obligatoriu. Și marile întreprinderi trebuie să ia măsuri pentru a evita risipa de energie. De exemplu, companiile care distribuie energie vor trebui să-și îmbunătățească rețelele de distribuție pentru electricitate și gaz. Industriile mari consumatoare de energie vor trebui să fie foarte atente la consum. Scopul este utilizarea mai eficientă a energiei. Și ce facem pentru acest lucru? Până în ianuarie 2015, distribuitorii de energie vor fi obligați să-și informeze clienții mai clar. Facturile trebuie să fie mai simple, iar locuințele să fie echipate cu noi tipuri de contoare, astfel încât să înțelegem unde, când, cum și câtă energie consumăm în gospodărie. Între timp, nimic nu ne împiedică să alegem aparate economice. Să oprim alimentarea când nu folosim un aparat, chiar și modul stand-by. Să reducem încălzirea și să ne îmbrăcăm mai gros. Să reciclăm blugii vechi ca material de izolare. Poftim? Eu trebuie să fiu un exemplu? Ok! Până în 2020, consum redus cu 20%. Statele membre vor trebui să prezinte planul lor de acțiune și să raporteze evoluția la fiecare 6 luni. Vom reveni și noi cu noutăți. Pe curând!
Will Latvia become the 18th member of the Eurozone? Today it took one step closer as the government in Riga officially put in their bid for membership. But opinion polls show 59% of Latvians are against it. So what is the path ahead? We asked two Latvian MEPs, Ivar Godmanis and Tatjana Danoka, their opinions. Are you for or against membership?
Yes, absolutely, I'm in favor. There are several reasons why. The first one, we are very deeply integrated in Europe. Our exports is something around 77% to Europe.
I think it's not time to join Eurozone just now in the time of crisis. We have to wait at least until 2014.
Public opinion is against the euro, so why adopt it?
People's opinion is very negative with respect to euro. Our situation, economic situation, will be worsened just to fulfill this Maastricht criteria.
De facto, the people already agreed with euros. As I said, if you have taken 80% loans in euros and you keep your deposits in euros, actually you agreed.
What's Latvia's future in the eurozone?
For me, it's no risk to say the bright future or the bad future. But we are one of the first countries who already have passed the fiscal stability law, which is toughest law in the EU.
We have an unemployment. We are the third poorest country in the European Union. There is no prosper future for our country.
The biggest trade deal that's been years in the making could finally be on the cards. Both the United States and European Union are keen to start negotiations to establish a transatlantic trade and investment partnership.
The EU and the US have the largest economic relationship in the world. Two-way trade totals 600 billion euros annually. A lot of hype and enthusiasm surrounds this potential FTA, but what will it actually mean for the way in which we do business with other countries, and how will it affect European citizens? Let's see what MEPs have to say.
For the MEP who wrote the report, with the failure of WTO multilateral trade talks, the impetus to drive forward negotiations with the US is now more than ever.
Positive externalities of this agreement will be to reassert the leadership of the Union and the United States when it comes to rulemaking, standard setting.
Under the deal, the removal of trade barriers could raise Europe's GDP by 190 billion euros. It would also lead to the creation of jobs and big investment. But any trade deal with the US needs parliamentary approval, and many MEPs have voiced concerns.
Everybody in the EU says we don't want the American way of life, we don't want. But what we want is also that the Americans are dealing with us on the same level.
Skeptics say the economies on both sides will only be boosted by around 1%. The pact would weaken the WTO and the EU's trade relations with other countries.
We will not abandon any of the other negotiations we are dealing with. Even a slight increase of the exchanges will bring about a huge added value in terms of growth and jobs in other side of the Atlantic.
President Barack Obama has given it his backing, and pushing through a deal before he leaves office could be the long-lasting economic legacy of his presidency. At a debate between Health Commissioner Tonio Borge and members of Parliament's Environment Committee on Thursday, it was agreed that more systematic controls, inspections and labelling was needed to gain back consumer confidence following the horse meat scandal.
We cannot not only recommend certain inspections when things of this kind arise, but also binding member states to do so. With the results of the inspections in the month of March, we can come to the conclusion whether these are just ordinary criminal activity or much more than that.
Despite concerns, MEPs seem confident that member states would comply with new rules.
I'm very confident that they will be tightening up their supply chain traceability, that they will be making sure that what it says on the label is what is actually in the packet, and they will be increasing the frequency of spot checks.
The biggest shake-up to the banking system could be on the way. European officials have struck a provincial deal on financial rules, including capping bank bonuses under the Capital Requirements Directive. Otmar Karas says from 2014, European banks will have set aside more money for stability and concentrate on financing the real economy, small and medium-sized enterprises and jobs.
We have a revolution beschlossen, dass die Boni für Manager gedeckelt sind und nicht höher sein dürfen als der Grundgehalt. Wenn sie auf 1:2 gesteigert werden, dann benötigt das einen Beschluss der Hauptversammlung.
It was a meeting of European solidarity as José Manuel Barroso, Martin Schulz and leaders of the Irish presidency met in Dublin. But 2 weeks before MEPs are expected to vote at the plenary on the EU's reduced seven-year budget, Parliament's president has put a real spanner in the works, saying it's most likely that the majority of MEPs will say no to the budget proposal, adding that it changes nothing in agriculture, cohesion or investment. So it would seem a lot more compromise and discussion may be needed before a decision on the budget will be reached. But I've promised you.
Bonjour, je m'appelle Gwenaëlle et je suis belge. Il paraît que l'Europe investit beaucoup dans sa politique régionale, mais en quoi ça consiste exactement?
Nous sommes à Mons, dans le Hainaut, la région la plus pauvre de Belgique. Et pourtant, ce parc scientifique est à la pointe de la recherche dans certains domaines. Derrière moi, il y a un laboratoire qui se concentre sur la recherche et le développement de certains matériaux, dont le plastique. Là-bas, c'est un centre de recherche et d'innovation des télécommunications. Si ce parc scientifique a pu voir le jour, c'est grâce à un budget dont la moitié a été financée par l'Union européenne. Au total, près de 38 millions d'euros ont été injectés avant 2007 par la politique régionale de l'Union dans le développement de ce projet. L'objectif, relancer l'économie dans la région. Objectif atteint, 57 entreprises sont aujourd'hui implantées sur le site scientifique, ce qui représente 644 emplois de plus pour la région. Victime de son succès, le parc scientifique est en phase d'élargissement de l'autre côté de l'autoroute. Entre 2007 et 2013, ce sont 19 millions d'euros qui seront investis, notamment dans ce projet de reconversion économique. Allons voir ça de plus près. Innovation, amélioration des infrastructures routières ou encore création d'emplois, l'objectif de la politique régionale de l'Union européenne est de renforcer la cohésion économique et sociale entre les différentes régions de l'Union et donc d'aplanir les inégalités de développement.
Les moyens qui sont rendus disponibles, c'est très simple, ça s'articule en trois axes. Le premier, c'est le développement économique, c'est-à-dire qu'il s'agit d'aider les entreprises à s'implanter à travers des zoning ou des aides très concrètement dont le montant est supérieur à ce qu'elles pourraient avoir autrement. Et deuxièmement, c'est favoriser le capital humain avec le développement de la recherche et du développement et aussi, bien sûr, en matière de formation. Et enfin, parce que c'est important aussi pour augmenter l'attractivité, favoriser le développement urbain et le développement territorial.
L'Union européenne prend soin de ses 271 régions. Pour la période 2007 à 2013, elle leur a réservé un budget de 308 milliards d'euros. C'est le deuxième poste de dépenses de l'UE.
La majorité des crédits, 82%, va aux régions les plus pauvres de l'UE. C'est l'objectif convergence. Sont éligibles les régions dont le PIB par habitant est inférieur à 75% de la moyenne de l'Union européenne, soit 99 régions dont la plupart sont situées dans les nouveaux États membres.
La politique régionale, en quelque sorte, peut être comparée à une escadrille. Il s'agit de faire en sorte que l'ensemble des éléments de l'escadrille puissent grimper rapidement, et donc on leur donne de l'argent pour ce faire.
16% des fonds de la politique régionale visent aussi la compétitivité et la création d'emplois. Cet objectif couvre toutes les régions d'Europe non concernées par le premier objectif, soit 172 régions au total. Enfin, 2,5% seulement des fonds sont consacrés à la coopération territoriale européenne qui concerne toutes les régions, soit 271 régions.
Alors, en ce qui concerne la coopération transfrontalière, je pense qu'on met un peu trop l'accent sur la dimension économique et pas suffisamment sur ce qui est au fond lié à la vie quotidienne, la mobilité, la santé, la coopération en matière culturelle, universitaire et autres.
Mais que se passera-t-il après 2014? C'est la question. Les régions riches craignent de se voir privées de leurs fonds par mesure d'austérité, à tel point que leurs représentants ont manifesté en 2010. Dans tous les cas, ce qui est sûr, c'est qu'il y aura une réforme de la politique régionale. Mais pour changer quoi?
Il faudra faire preuve de plus de sélectivité et envisager des analyses coût-efficacité qui permettront d'utiliser les fonds qui manifestement seront inférieurs à ce qu'on a pu avoir jusqu'à présent, mais en tentant d'obtenir un résultat qui soit raisonnablement plus efficace.
Quoi qu'il arrive, le financement de la prochaine politique régionale sera étroitement lié à la recherche et au développement.